Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to TechGeek webinars, our endeavor to empower techies. TechGeek.com believes that sharing of knowledge is the key of enhancing our performances and for our growth as professionals. TechGeek webinars is a small initiative in our effort to share knowledge with tech professionals. Today's webinar topic is code walkthrough using MongoDB with Java. We are delighted to have Mr. Vipin Vindal today to speak about use of MongoDB with Java. Vipin is an engineering graduate from IIT Delhi, working with Times Group in capacity of assistant manager. He has a rich experience of 5+ years on development of web applications using Java or J2EE technologies. Vipin has a strong focus on following best practices of code development like code reviews, test-driven development, design, code modularity, code reuse, etc. Gentlemen, this presentation will continue for next 45 minutes. And we will take your questions after the presentation. In the meanwhile, you can post your queries through the chat pane available in the webinar software. Without further ado, I introduce you to our guest speaker, Vipin. Hello everybody. So today we are here for a session on integrating MongoDB with Java. So first of all, let's talk about what exactly is MongoDB. So MongoDB is basically used for storing huge data in which basically we can perform some basic operations like insert, delete, find, etc. very fastly, basically CRUD operations. So it is very useful, handy in applications in which there is a huge amount of data flown, like we can say Facebook, Twitter, Times of India, etc. We know that for these apps, user base is so big that data identification for a user, or basically getting the data for a user, should be very efficient and should be very fast. We all know that these databases, basically databases work on ACID principles, so which ensure each request going to DB should be inserted into the database. But this is not the case with Mongo, as this is a non-relational and non-transactional DB. So the use case includes reporting applications, notification application, but strictly not financial applications, because in financial application, a little data loss can potentially cause huge problems. So MongoDB should be explicitly used for reporting applications or the application which are basically based on notifications framework like Facebook, Twitter and all. So let's talk about the features of MongoDB. So, MongoDB, the name has come from humongous. Humongous, as the name suggests, humongous is huge, where the quantity is huge. So basically, in applications like Facebook and Twitter, the amount of data that is flown is very huge. So if they basically work on traditional databases like RDBMS, the performance will be very low. So here we need databases which can work on huge data. So let's talk about the features that MongoDB provide. So MongoDB is scalable. It is very high on performance. It is basically a document oriented database. So it is not only SQL, but it is non-relational. Non-relational in the sense like you don't have relations in the database, and it is a distributed, open source and schema free database. We will talk about schema-free database in detail afterwards. It is a scalable database, it is an API-driven database, and it is easily replicable. So what exactly I mean by document oriented database. Like basically the entries in the database are in JSON format, which is basically document. It is schema free, as I have already told you. It is basically performant. Basically it support index, full support for indexing. You can do reverse indexing, you can do composite indexing, you can do indexing on a single column. Replication and sharding are quite easy and hassle free to implement. Now unlike other relational databases where you strictly need to define a schema of a table, columns, their types, here is in Mongo it is basically a n cross m collection which is of type JSON. So suppose you want to make a table in suppose Oracle, where it is a student table. So it is basically, suppose you have two attributes, name and age. So if I want to insert data in the data in the table, so then you have to specify name and age. But in MongoDB you need not to define like how much columns my table will contain, and in my columns basically it could be a n cross m structure, so at runtime there could be n number of columns. So basically what exactly is they basically work on JSON principle. So at runtime a entry which is basically a JSON, which is, what exactly is a JSON? So JSON is a key value pair in which number of pairs can be dynamic. So suppose the attributes which you are inserting into the table, the attributes can be A, B, C, D, so there can be n number of columns, and each column can itself be a JSON again. So each column can itself be a map again. So A can contain other attributes which is suppose X, Y, Z. So you can say it is basically a map in which each entry of the map can itself be a map. So let's see an example. So basically I am inserting a row which is basically db.foo. So in the database I have a collection which is foo, in which I am inserting a author attribute. The name of the column is basically author, and author in itself contains the attribute which is name, and the name is Vipin. So basically the attribute can itself be a map in which it can contain name and value. So now if you see downwards, you can now in the same collection you can insert like db.foo.insert, where author, name is Vipin and age is 29. So at runtime you can add attributes to a column. So number of attributes which you can define in a column are dynamic. So this is not possible in case of other relational databases. Let's talk about document databases. So what exactly is a document? So here we can see, so here we have a document in which we have an attribute author and which has a name. So if I want to basically do a query, give me all those entries in which author has a name Vipin. So I can easily do it in Mongo by doing give me all the entries where author dot name is Vipin. But this is not possible in case of relational databases. In relational databases, if I want to maintain some relation, I have to basically insert this name is equal to Vipin in another table. So basically in that case I have to perform a join query. So join queries, as you know, are basically they reduce the performance of select, but this is not the case with Mongo. So now basically let's do a comparison of the comparison with other relational databases. So first of all let's see the terminology. So in other relational databases, if we talk about database, then in Mongo we also have database. In other relational database, where what we call table is actually a collection in Mongo, what we call row in a relational database is actually a document in Mongo, what we call column in a relational database is a field. So let's see how a sample entry in a Mongo database look like. So this is the example of a sample entry in which basically we have a ID which is basically kind of a primary key generated by the Mongo database. Here we have the attributes. Okay, title is Mongo introduction, speaker is Vipin, and here are some tags which is Mongo and NoSQL. So if I want to basically do some query, okay, give me these entries where title is this and the tag contains NoSQL. So these kind of queries are very simple or can be performed in Mongo, but not with relational databases. So now let's talk about MongoDB system. So MongoDB system basically comprises of two components. One is MongoD and another is Mongo. So MongoD is the server on which basically database run, and Mongo is the shell to interact with the server. So now let's talk about how we basically install Mongo database. So the installer can be downloaded from the website of Mongo, which is basically mongodb.org. When installer is downloaded, then you can extract that installer to /opt/mongodb as per your choice. Then after that, we need to create a data folder, which is /opt/mongodata/db, which is the path where all the data files are stored. Suppose you have some collections, so data of these collections are stored in this data folder. So now after that, you need to create a run script. Run script is basically to start the database server. So let's see what exactly contains in run script. So basically run script says this is the path where we have the daemon. This is basically available with the distribution that we have downloaded from Mongo website. This is the path where we store the data. This is the path where all the logs are created. So we can create a run.sh in which you can include this command. Then when we do sh run.sh, then Mongo daemon is started. So now Mongo DB server is up and the server is running on port 27017. So now let's see some commands which basically gets executed on MongoDB server. So if we do show DBs, then it shows the name of the databases. If we do show collections, then it shows the collections basically which are present in a database. It is just like show tables in any other relational database. So these are some custom commands. If I talk about current OP, so basically it shows me all the current queries which are getting executed on the database. So if I want to basically know like what all select queries are getting fired or what all insert queries are getting fired, I can do that by using db.currentop. For dropping a database, I use db.dropDatabase. I can also kill a process by using db.killOP. While executing a command, you have several options. Like you can basically run a command in background. What does background means? Basically, if we run a command by setting, okay, run this command in background, then basically the command gets run like a daemon thread. And what is the advantage of the daemon thread? Suppose if I do db.currentop or db.dropDatabase, then any other query which is getting executed on the database, then by that query the lock is not obtained on the database. So this is the biggest advantage by options that you provide while executing a command. So now let's see what all commands we can execute on a collection. Collection is basically a table in case of a relational database. So before that, let's see basically how these commands get run in Mongo shell. So I have recently told you that Mongo comprises of two components. One is MongoD, which is the basically database server. Another is Mongo. Mongo is the shell which basically connects to the Mongo daemon. So basically you can say like it's just like a MySQL terminal client. So slash opd slash mongodb slash bin. This is the path where you have extracted the binaries of Mongo. Mongo is the daemon which basically connects you to the interactive shell. So if I do slash opd slash mongodb slash bin slash mongo, then it basically connects me to the server. So by default it connects to me, connects to test database. So if I do a show db, which we have already seen in mongodb command, so it shows me all the databases which are currently present in the server. So here we have, you can see we have an admin database, we have a master database. This is a database which we basically use for our application. Test database is the default database that is basically used for testing purposes, and it is provided by the Mongo. Now suppose I want to use master database, so then I can use master. So in this I basically have switched to master database. Now if I want to see what all tables or collections that are present in master database, then I have to fire a command which is basically show collections. So show collections shows me like there is a process collection that is present in master database. Okay, so now I want to basically see what all data is present in process collection. So I have to do db.process.find. So find query is basically executed on the process collection. So here I see, okay, the process contains an entry which has a ID, which I said that this is the primary key that is generated by the MongoDB server, and this is a attribute which is a name, which is a name of a process, process name, contact, candidate. Okay, and now there is another command. If I do db.currentop, then it basically return me IDs of all those queries which are getting executed on server. As you can see that it is an empty array, so right now no queries are getting executed on the server. I have shown already shown you how basically you can run document queries in Mongo. So here I basically insert a entry, then I can basically run a find command on that query. So here I see that my database is foo, my collection is foo, and I am basically inserting an author which has attributes this. So if I want to basically find an author which has a name Vipin, then I can do db.foo.find author.name Vipin. Okay, so it basically return me the entry which was inserted by the previous command. So if I do a db.foo.insert author name is Vipin and age is 29, then basically again another entry is inserted, and that entry can be found by this db.foo.found where author.age is 29. So now let's see what are the commands that Mongo provides for a collection. Collection is basically a table in case of a relational database. So you can see db.collection.drop. So this is basically for dropping a table or a collection. And suppose you have a index on a collection, so basically this is how you can drop an index. If you want to drop all the indexes, then basically you can do drop indexes. This is the way by which basically we create an index. So this is the attribute on which I want to make a index. So this is 1, and ts is equal to -1. This means reverse indexing. So basically search will be done on a reverse basis, and these are the options that I provide while executing a query, which is background is equal to true. Like the indexing will be done in the background, like as a daemon thread. So the advantage of this is while making indexes, no lock will be taken on this particular collection. This is not possible in case of another relational database. If I basically create index on any other relational database, what it will do, it will take a lock on the database, and if in the meanwhile if there are some insert, delete or update queries getting fired on the database, those query won't be executed. So by providing a background is equal to true, you can basically make sure that it don't take a lock, and it runs on a as a daemon thread. So this is how we basically get to know what all indexes are present in a collection. If I want to rename a collection, then I can use a rename collection command. If I want to drop a collection, then I can drop a collection. If I want to see what is the size allocated to a collection, then I can do that. So these are basically some commands which are basically collection specific or are specific to a table. So here we can see like the Mongo understand the language of JSON. So here we can see all the things like all the queries. Basically, if I talk about the insert queries, then this is a JSON. This is basically a key value pair. So this is the key, this is the value, and the value can itself again be a JSON. So this is a map which can, this is a map in which the value of an entry can itself be a map. Here you can see the value of author is name Vipin. So name is name and Vipin, this is again part of another map. So this is basically map of map. So here we see some commands which are that we generally run on a relational database, and this is the command that we usually run on a Mongo database. So if I want to basically create a table, then I use create tables user, where A is a number and B is a number, and here I just create db.create collection users. So here the biggest difference that you can see is that relational databases are very schema bounded. So while creating a table which is user, you have to specify what all attributes will be there. So here you can see that A is one attribute and B is another attribute. So if I want to basically add another attribute, then I have to make a alter to the table, and then finally another attribute can be inserted. But this is not the case with Mongo, as I already told you that this is a n cross m collection. So here we just need to fire command db.create collections users, so that the collection is created and JSON objects can be inserted to these users table. So now I see, if I want to insert some specific values, insert into users values 3, 5. So here I can do db.users.insert a3b5. So here you can see in my initial command I have only created users, but I have not specified what all attributes will be there. And in the second command I am inserting a is equal to 3 and b is equal to 5. So basically now you can see here, okay, so the users can is basically now containing two attributes, where a is 3 and b is 5. So if I basically want to again fire a query which basically says db.users.insert a:3 b:5 c:7, then there would be a second entry where it will contain three attributes. So here each row can have different number of columns. So that's why this is called a n cross m collection, where first row can have 4 attributes, second row can 10 attributes, third row can have 15 attributes. So this is not schema bound. So there is no explicit boundation on any schema. So after that, suppose I want to fire a select query, select a comma b from user. Similarly, I can basically do a query on find from the users where a is where find a and b from users. If I want to basically add some condition, then I can do db.users.find age, where age is 33. So these are the queries. So suppose if I want to find some column based on some condition, then I can do them. I can basically fire like queries, I can basically fire range queries, I can basically fire queries which returns me a result which is sorted on some order. So here we see name is -1, so this is descending order. So I already told you that Mongo has a full indexing support. So you can have composite indexes, you can have reverse indexes, you can have indexes on a single column as well. So suppose I want to find a count, so I can do db.users.count. If I want to do update, then I can do that. So now let's see. So till now we have seen what exactly is Mongo, where Mongo database should be used. It should be used for reporting applications or applications where we use notification modules, or any application which has a huge data flow where we want queries, CRUD queries, which should be executed very fast. Like we can say insert, delete, update, select. Okay, so now let's see the integration of Mongo with Java. So here I will show you some code snippet of a web application which is basically built in Spring MVC. So like Spring provides a interface, Spring provides a interface which is basically Hibernate DAO support to integrate with to use Hibernate as a plugin and to integrate it with another databases. So similarly, Spring also provides a module to integrate with Mongo, which is Spring Data MongoDB.jar. This is the jar which provides standard classes to integrate with Mongo. This is after that we have Mongo 2.6.3.jar, which basically contains the drivers which have the logic to insert the data into Mongo database. So I will show you my project hierarchy. So this is the source folder where I have all the source code. This is the web content folder, and here I have application context.xml. This is the Mongo config, application context, Mongo config. Mongo config is the file where I basically configure Mongo. This is my servlet. So let's see how exactly Mongo config look like. Mongo config. So in my Mongo config, basically I make a bean in which I specify in which server my Mongo DB is running. So you can see, so when I executed a shrun.sh, which is basically this script. So after running this script, Mongo daemon has started. So MongoDB server is up and the port on which it runs is 27017. So similarly, in Mongo config, I specify on which server it is running, the IP of that server, and on which port it is running. So this is basically defining where my Mongo is running. After that, I can define templates. So this is basically some custom code which is provided by Spring. So here it says in the constructor it takes a ref, it's Mongo, it takes Mongo as an argument. So basically Mongo template takes, okay, where my server is deployed, and the second argument which is master. So it says, okay, what database to connect. So it knows which database to connect and it knows where to connect. So similarly, I can define many other templates in which I can define where my server is running and which database to connect. So there can be n number of beans in which I can define where my server is running and on to which database it should be connected. So here you can see, unlike any other Java application where we are strictly bounded to one database, here you can connect to any number of databases you want to. You just need to create templates. So let's see. So this is the configuration of Mongo. So in which basically we define where my server is running and what all templates are there to connect to whichever databases. So now let's see my configuration of the servlet. So here I have a DAO in which in the constructor of that DAO I basically defined which template to use. So now I know my DAO is basically connected to which server and which database. The second thing is com.tj.nif.domain.notification. So this is the model object which the DAO is inserting to the database. So this is the object which is getting inserted into the database. So the first argument is to which database and which server I am inserting the data. The second argument is what it is the model which I am inserting in my database. And the second argument is, okay, I know which database I am going to insert my data. And the third argument tells me the collection or the name of the table in which I am going to insert my data. So like you can see, like in you can see here I do show db. So this is master is my one of the db, and in master I see process is one of my collection. So similarly here I know which collection to use, and Mongo templates define which database to use, and what is the first and the second argument is which model to use. Now let's see the application context. So application context, I just defined use this configuration file for the configuration of Mongo. Now let's see the web.xml. This is the standard web.xml in which basically I am loading the application context, in which I am defining, okay, from where I am going to pick my Mongo configuration, and in my servlet I am just defining all my DAOs. So here we see the notification model. So what exactly is my notification model? So the first attribute of the notification model, this is underscore ID. It represents the ID which is generated by the Mongo database when we insert any model or any document. Like here, when we do a insert db.foo.insert, so then that entry is inserted with a ID. So this is the primary key that is being generated. So now FO and PN, these are my two another attributes. So now let's see the controller layer. So I have a login controller which basically takes a HTTP request. From the HTTP request, I basically get my data. So I get my name of the process, I get the name of the folder, then I basically populate my notification model. And when once my notification object is populated, then I can save my notification DAO to save the notification. So what exactly is notification DAO? So here I am passing an object to the notification DAO. So here notification DAO. So I am passing the notification object. So here you can say com.tj.nf domain notification. So it is the type which is handled by notification DAO. Now let's see Mongo DAO support. So this is a very important class. This class is basically provided by Spring. So Mongo DAO support basically uses Mongo template class by Spring to perform basic data operations to DB. So Mongo, you can see the code for the Mongo DAO support is templatized. So as you can see the constructor of this, so it takes a Mongo template. It takes key like, okay, what kind of model it is going to insert and in which collection it is going to insert the data. And it basically provide all the basic operation, okay, create a collection. So basically while creating collection, it is basically using Mongo template, and in the Mongo template we have already defined which database to use. So basically it will create this collection in that particular database. If I want to drop collection, then I can use that. If I want to ensure some index, if I want to save some object, if I want to find some object. So there are many features of this class. So here we see notification DAO. So as we have shown you notification DAO, so the constructor of the notification DAO takes Mongo template, model and the collection. So here the notification DAO is basically extending Mongo DAO support, which is taking notification as a model. So notification, the constructor of the notification DAO IMPL, it takes the Mongo template, it takes which class I am going to insert, what is the collection in which I am going to insert. So it basically creates object of the Mongo DAO support, and once object of the Mongo DAO support is created, then if I call save notification, then it basically takes MongoDAO support dot insert name of the collection, which is basically passed here, and the object that I am going to insert. So what MongoDAO support do? It basically save the object. So here it is basically calling Mongo template, and Mongo template is a class by Spring. So what Mongo template do? Basically, now Mongo understand the language of JSON. So it don't understand what is a Java object or what is a C object. It only understand JSON. So JSON is quite a standard format in which the value, in which they basically it is key value pair. So now Mongo converter use reflections, Java reflections, to convert that Java object into a JSON object. So by using reflection, it basically takes out all the list of the attributes, and it takes out all the values of the attributes, and then basically creates a JSON object. And once the JSON object is created, then it is inserted into the Mongo database using drivers provided by Mongo, that you can see here. So here basically we are inserting a JSON document. So this JSON document is created by Mongo template, and that is communicated to Mongo jar, which contains the driver to connect to MongoDB. So this is how data is getting inserted into Mongo database. Now let's see how we basically fetch data from the database. So similarly, in my notification, I can write a method which is basically getting notification. Okay, so get notification. So here I have an argument called string folder. So basically here I make a query. Query is equal to new query. This query class is also provided by Spring. So in this query, I can basically add a condition where folder is ABCD, and then basically I fire that query. So Mongo template internally converts this query object into a JSON query and fire that query to Mongo database. So the results are also returned in format of JSON. So what Spring provides as an advantage is it basically converts. So here you can see in the find query, I am specifying from which collection I have to fire the query, what is the query, and what kind of objects I am expecting. So it is basically executing that query. It is getting the results in JSON format, and that JSON is basically mapped to notification.class. So while inserting a Java object, it basically converts that Java object into a JSON, and while fetching the data, it converts the JSON to a Java object. So that automatically mapping conversion is done by Spring. So if you don't want to use Spring functionality, then you have to implement Java reflections. So in this session, we have seen, so what exactly is Mongo database? What are the advantages of Mongo database over any other relational database? What is the comparison of Mongo database with any other relational database? What all commands do we execute on Mongo database? So we have seen Mongo database commands, Mongo collection commands. We have seen how to integrate Mongo with Java. We have seen how to do basic CRUD operations, and we have seen basically inserting a document, fetching a document. So that is all regarding MongoDB. So any questions? So Praveen, you have asked what is foo in the commands. So foo is the name of the collection. This is एक्चुअली इट्स अ फनी नेम, सो इट इज नेम ऑफ एनी कलेक्शन, सो यू कैन स्पेसिफाई, यू कैन स्पेसिफाई एनी नेम इन द कलेक्शन. Yeah, Kapil, I can say should one use MySQL or MongoDB as a code databases when you are trying to build a social network similar to Facebook. So if I talk about the relation between object or the custom logic like friend list or something like that, so in that case you have to use a relational database. But when it talks about like if I want to get some update from my friend network, or basically I want to share something, or basically I want to post something which is basically visible to all, or basically I am broadcasting something, so then those things are very data intensive. So in that case basically we should use Mongo database. And there is another question, how MongoDB is different from MySQL. So this is a very basic question that I answered in the presentation that you can see. That you can see basically this is a very high performing database. This is a document oriented database, like I showed you, like basically if you want to perform this kind of queries in which basically I want to find a specific attribute from a column, then this is not possible in case of relational databases. For that basically you have to find a, basically you have to do a join query. Yeah, Shubhan, I can see your question. In case of broadcasting, can you please explain how will be the table structure? So basically, we have implemented broadcasting in one of our applications. In our application, what we do, we basically send some specific messages to our user, and we also send some messages which are for all, which is basically broadcasting. So in that case, so if I talk about specific messages, then basically for with every message I have an attribute which is called user ID. So user ID says this entry is for specifically for this user. So when I want to